I'm Hannah Thomas from Ffilm Cymru, and I'm joined by the very dapper Peter Smyth, who's made an effort to come to Cardiff tonight, and very smart, he is too, who is one of the producers of Lady Macbeth. I just thought maybe you could, and I've obviously introduced you, but say a little bit about kind of what you've been up to and your journey in the media and how you kind of settled on becoming a producer.
Sure. When I was at university doing a completely unrelated degree when I was about 18 years old, as a part-time job, I started working as like a film and television extra. And it was just like the coolest job to have as a student.
What were you on?
Hollyoaks, Coronation Street. I was in the film Alfie, like
That's
Millions.
That's so cool.
Well, it seemed super cool at the time.
I stacked shelves when I was in university.
Well, that's it. Everybody else was working in sort of Tesco, and I got to be on TV, so it was fantastic.
Cool.
But because I was on these sort of soap operas, I would, I'd be doing the same thing week after week, and I'd just get to know the runners, and one week on Hollyoaks, one of the runners or third AD said, look, we're really short staff. Do you fancy running for us today? So I started working as a runner that way. And I found that I much preferred being a runner to being an extra. So I started doing that as a student job.
And busier.
Yeah, well, much busier and so much more interesting for a kind of 19, 20-year-old. So I just sort of carried on with that after I left university. And then, I worked as an art department assistant, I was a camera assistant, I ended up working sort of as a production assistant for BBC television and BBC radio drama before that. And then, I decided I wanted to be a producer. I just thought it was the role on a film set that I found the most interesting and exciting.
And why do you think that?
I don't know. I mean, it seems I always liked the idea of being the person who sort of makes the project happen in a way. So you're the person who picks up the phone, and in a way everybody else is waiting for the phone to ring. So that aspect of it. And I was like a huge, well still am, but I used to be a huge James Bond fan as a kid. And as a series that's so producer led and so producer dominated.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think even as a kid I always grew up thinking, oh, the producers are the most important guys. So it was, I just had that in my head. So I went to the National Film and Television School in Beaconsfield and studied producing there. Did that for a couple of years and came out and, sort of hit the road and started producing features, or in this case, sort of associate producing a feature.
I mean, lots of people here tonight are part of our Cinematic scheme. So Cinematic, if you're not part of it, is kind of Ffilm Cymru's low-budget feature film initiative, whereby about 300,000 is given to three films to be made, and we're on our second iteration. And this was made through iFeatures, which is Creative England's equivalent scheme. So I hope everyone on Cinematic is feeling really inspired, because I think it's pretty remarkable what's been achieved, actually. So firstly, what was the budget for this, if you don't mind me asking?
No, of course not. The budget for this was £550,000. It was initially, the iFeature scheme was pitched at £350,000, but the BFI, BBC Films and Creative England, who run iFeatures, partnered with a sort of EIS fund called Old Garth Media, who then sort of funded a little bit extra. So yeah, just over £500,000.
But still a very low budget feature, in the scheme of things. I think it's really remarkable what's been achieved. But I mean, what made you go down the iFeatures route? Was it necessity? Had you tried to get it financed? Or was this conceived of as an iFeatures, as a low budget film?
It was conceived of as a low budget film, for sure. I mean, it was the director, Will, got to know the writer Alice, and both come from a theatre background. Alice is a sort of, a very successful theatre writer. Will, a very successful theatre director. They got to know each other, not actually through the theatre, because they're both smokers, and they just constantly found themselves hanging out in the same spot in Golden Square in London. Got to talking, realised they did the same thing, both fancied a film. They came up with this idea, which was something I think Alice had read. It's based on a Russian novella from about 1865 called Lady Macbeth of Matensk, which was then turned into an opera. It's kind of quite a famous opera. It was actually running at the time we were making this, which was a bit weird. But they went to, they met with Fowler, the lead producer on the project, and it was her who suggested, look, this could really work for iFeatures. It's just about that right budget level, about 350 we thought at the time, and it's doable, it's contained, there's a fairly small cast of characters, and it's a relatively contained location. So Fowler, in those early stages of development with them, sort of set about shaping it so it could be a low-budget film and constraining the location amongst everything else.
Yeah, I guess that's his kind of strength. I mean, I was going to ask, kind of creatively, is that probably the best decision that was made in terms of being able to get the film to fit the budget, just containing it and making it just doable and not having those moves?
Yeah, 100%. Mm-hmm. I've made three micro-budget films now in sort of various capacities, and the two of them that were didn't nearly give me a heart attack were relatively contained and they worked, and another one had about 60 locations
for
a similar budget. Well, it was very difficult. I mean, being able to do that, film everything in the same location and have a unit base in the same location, It just made the whole thing achievable. So actually, it was, even though the budget was small, we didn't feel stretched. It didn't feel like a micro-budget usually feels.
Now, how long was the shoot?
The shoot was 4 weeks.
So I'd asked Pete beforehand to share an anecdote about kind of what went wrong, and he's like, oh, nothing. And you're saying that it was actually a ridiculously straightforward shoot, which is lovely to hear and kind of must be very gratifying.
But utterly useless right now.
Yeah, kind of useless. But I mean, maybe you could say why you think it was such a smooth shoot and what was it that made it kind of run so effortlessly?
Because ask me about any other film I've ever worked on, it's just a litany of disasters, which are horrible at the time, but hilarious when recounting them in a Q&A. But with this, I think we were very fortunate in that it was so contained. If you watch the film, it's very dramatic and so on and so forth, but really there's only sort of two action scenes in them, if you could really call them that, three.
Yeah.
You know, we have a child, we have a horse, but, you know, it was a relatively simple production to stage. But really, the big thing that helped us out was we were very fortunate to get incredibly experienced HODs. So actually, above the level that we would have expected to get for a film at this budget level, you know, we had an experienced editor, we had an experienced production designer, an experienced director of photography, and a hugely experienced first AD, which really made things run smoothly. And that, you notice that it just made everything run so much more smoothly. I think one of the huge advantages for shooting a film on this budget was Will, who is an incredibly talented film director, but from his background as being a talented theatre director, you know, he was used to working with, you know, not necessarily having to rely on every single little trick that he could use that was just a camera shot was sort of new to him. So actually, he was used to just relying on the power of the actors and the power of the story. So that really helped in a big, big way. Likewise, the location we were incredibly fortunate to find, because it's just a beautiful location. And more or less, I mean, the set dressing for it was very extensive, and our production designer and art director did a huge amount of work. But actually, we had such a great canvas for them to work on, which was just so lucky. I mean, we got it for an absolute song.
And the surrounding countryside, you know, when you see it, it's so dramatic. The skies are so big, and you really kind of have that sense of being in the wild, and the sound that comes in as well, and the kind of how the sound's been designed with the waterfall crashing in, and the shots when we're following him. We really feel, I think, when we're out of the house, it's really bedded in nature, and it's got a real sense of place, which I think just really helps us feel have a connection with it.
I think that's what we really wanted, and particularly I think it helps because the film is so claustrophobic, particularly towards the beginning within the house. When you go outside, you really feel the impact of those big skies. And a friend of mine who's a film director, but he insists on doing as much as he can outdoors, because he says the best shot you can ever get, the best production design you can ever have is just a beautiful mountain or a beautiful sky. So, you know, those those shots were great as well.
And there's lots of them in Wales, so, you know, for nothing else, yes. You can go outside and shoot. William and Florence, the director and the actress, were identified by BAFTA as part of their Breakthrough Brit scheme. How important are these schemes to help identify new talent, to help nurture new talent, and to give people an opportunity to be able to make their first feature, do you think?
They are hugely important, and I think, you know, you get sort of various levels of the schemes, and I think that the industry has, whether it's by design, I don't know, but it's managed to work it in such a way that it complements key talent, particularly actors and directors, yeah, at various levels. I mean, BAFTA is great and has been remarkably helpful in terms of allowing the film to reach an international audience, and particularly getting the film shown to sort of key viewers in the States and key industry people in the States. Because the Brits to Watch scheme, which was a thing that was on, the BAFTA Brits to Watch scheme, I mean, that was great. You know, the film screened over to, you know, dozens of decision makers in the States who really wanted to see the film, and it gave the
platform,
film that opportunity.
Yeah, and to be able to get out there, yeah.
But and likewise, you know, the industry has a whole range of schemes, not just for actors and directors, but across the entire spectrum of all the different filmmaking departments. I just think it's, you know, fostering new talent is incredibly important.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's, you know, what Ffilm Cymru does is as bread and butter Creative England.
It's often say, you know, it's kind of, as you know, it's essential. I mean, the whole industry is predicated on finding new talent to come through and to be able to kind of regenerate and rejuvenate what we say and what stories we tell. So, I mean, it is essential, absolutely. And it's just fantastic that there's kind of budgets achievable for people who are starting out. I'm going to open it up to questions before long, but I'm just going to ask the really awkward question. If there was one piece of advice only that you could kind of share with the producers who are up and coming, if you could distill all that knowledge, I mean, what one piece of advice do you think you could give?
It would be to plan the movie, I mean, I guess, as early as possible for the budget level, and do so realistically. And I mean, what we did, like I say, the iFeature scheme, when we first were thinking about entering it, we thought it was 350,000, so we had planned a £350,000 film. When we then had 550,000, that made a huge difference. We found that out quite early in the process.
So what kind of changed? What did you augment with that kind of 150,000 additional?
We had never sort of fully budgeted it at 350,000, so it wasn't like we were adding things to it. But basically, I guess, had we been told in the beginning, oh, it's a 500, you have half a million.
Yeah.
We would have had a few more locations, we might have thrown in a few more characters. You know, when a draft came back, we wouldn't have said, oh, cut out that scene because it's too expensive.
Yeah.
So it really helped us economise, you know, actually, in our mind, conceptualising the film at a lower budget level than we ended up having.
Yeah.
But I've made another couple of micro-budget films before this one, and I've been involved with sort of lots more. And the mistake that every single one has made, every single time I've done it before, we've always pushed it, we've always been a bit too ambitious. And it's great to be ambitious, but actually this has been the best experience I've had so far on it, because we weren't too ambitious. I mean, I guess we had always planned it for an art house audience, really, principally. I mean, we hadn't expected the film. We had never planned for the film to sort of, you know, receive as wide a release as it's going to get. So we'd very much planned it for a sort of festival audience and for people who enjoy, people who would be fans of Russian literature, people who would be fans of the opera, very sort of targeted, specific audiences. British art house film fans and international art house film fans. We now are having a slightly wider release than was ever planned, so it will be interesting to see how the film works with the general audience.
And what is the release strategy? Where is it going to be?
At the moment, we know that it is going to be released in the Curzon cinemas. We're pretty confident it's going to be released in another couple of cinema chains, but I'm not sure I'm allowed to say what they are yet. But it should be receiving it's going to be one of those you shouldn't have to travel far to see it.
You should be able to pick it up.
Exactly. It will be on at a a sort of local cinema across the country, and it's being released, I think it's being released in the States then just a couple of weeks after.
Brilliant.
Yeah. It was planned sort of right from the very beginning. Will was always adamant that he would not have music, you know, to the point where I kept on sort of budgeting for music, and we kept on sort of saying, look, let's talk to some composers. He just said, no, I won't do it. And, you know, the execs were understandably sort of not concerned about that, but they wanted to hedge the bets, and they insisted that we still allow for it and maybe pencil a composer, but Will just said, no, I'm not going to do it. And I think it's one of those things, had the film, you know, music so often just lifts a good film, but so often it can help sort of cover, you know, paper over cracks in the edit. And we were fortunate that the film actually, you know, the rushes we had were good, the footage we had was good, so it was never needed. So Will was able to sort of, he chalked that one up as a win. We all said to him at some point, we think you're going to need music in at least one scene, and it worked with that. We didn't storyboard the film, no. We didn't storyboard the film. We didn't storyboard the film in a traditional sense, drawn out. I guess another really useful thing in making another really useful thing in planning the film and making it run smoothly was we had a sort of longer prep period than we would usually have on a micro-budget film. You know, we were up there for about 8 weeks before we filmed. Only a really reduced unit, just sort of myself, Fowler, Will, and the first AD joined us a bit later. But Will was actually able to storyboard pretty much every single scene, but just using kind of like, it was actually Lego pieces, but just in the actual rooms. And the rooms weren't dressed, but, you know, he would just have tables in there, and he would, when it needed to be a wider shot, you know, he'd use a traffic cone instead, or, you know, a tennis ball or whatever. So it was storyboarded, but in a way that nobody could understand apart from Will. But he had it in his head how it worked. But, you know, if we had to describe it to the execs, yeah, he'd be saying, well, no, the sort of noddy doll is Catherine, and, you know, she's killing the traffic cone, which is Teddy.
At least, yeah, that's the thing. If he has that time to be able to have it all in his head before you start shooting, then lots of that work is done, and then probably, again, added to that lovely smooth shoot that you're very lucky in having.
Exactly. I mean, the extended prep period, because prep is always, you know, when you're planning, and, you know, you're always at that point in any film. I mean, I guess it's the same on sort of $200 million films, but you're there and you're trying to find a way to slash the costs. And just taking a week off prep is just one of the easiest things to do in the world. You know, do we really need to be there for 7 weeks? Just strip it back. And it's a false economy because it saved us. I mean, it would have saved us tens of thousands the amount of prep that we had in the end. But it was deliberate because actually the inside the house is absolutely perfect. The grounds are absolutely perfect. It was perfect in every way, except from the outside. The place is called Lambton Castle. And sort of most of it's not there anymore. Most of it was demolished deliberately in the 70s. But it looks very grand from the outside. I mean, a bit dilapidated, but it looks too big. Mm. You'd be thinking, okay, this guy would not be, you know, Mr. This guy would be Sir or Lord living in this place. So the plan was always that we would shoot some exteriors, you know, just sort of in pickups. And we would just find somewhere else to shoot during the edit and see what shots we needed. And, you know, it just so happened when we put it together, we didn't actually... It didn't feel like we needed it, and we felt it did actually, just like you say, help add to that sense of claustrophobia. The edit was, gosh, let me see. I want to go back and say it was about 18 weeks, I think. Yeah, about 18 weeks. It was bridging over Christmas because we finished shooting in October, so we had a 2-week break for Christmas. We had a couple of little week breaks built in. We had about 3 financier screenings during that time. But I mean, again, we just sort of hit the deadlines. I mean, we were working with a great editor called Nick Emerson, who's, I mean, he's going on to do sort of fantastic things. I mean, he's getting quite big Hollywood offers already. But he was fantastic and sort of really useful, a very sort of experienced head to work with Will, because for Will, it was his first time in an edit, really.
So what's next for you? What's your next project?
The next project for me is something that we are hopefully working on together, which is called Kinkaseki.
Yeah.
Which is we're still at quite an early stage with that. We're at first draft, which we just submitted to you yesterday.
I've been told time and time again, it's first draft, disclaimer, and I'm like, it's fine. Yeah.
I'm really trying to set those expectations down there, so you're delighted. But it's really cool, actually. It's based on a true story, and it's set in 1950s Hong Kong, and it's about this guy who's a sort of multimillionaire, but he had been a Japanese prisoner of war, and it turns out he'd been secretly spending his fortune throughout his life on hunting down the guys who had been his captors in Japan and getting revenge on them. So it's a really interesting story, and it's with two very interesting writers. We don't have a director for it yet, but I guess we're hoping to shoot that sort of round about the middle of next year if we're able to sort of tick along with the development well enough.
But that's going to be a leap in budget then, isn't it? Period and set in Hong Kong.
Yes, it's going to be a big step up in budget. I think it's probably we've been looking at sort of round about 15 million or something like that for it, depending on who we get. Yeah. We keep on talking to Chinese financiers and they all want us to get Benedict Cumberbatch. They love him over there.
There's no one else. He's the only British
That's the
actor.
Only one they're interested
yeah, there's
in.
There's no one else for anyone.
We will be filming on location, but because it's in 1950s Hong Kong, Hong Kong itself now is almost, it's just too unrecognisable. Mm. So we're looking at probably filming probably mostly in Taiwan and maybe a little bit in mainland China. And a little bit in Wales, there's a bit in Cardiff now.
Yeah, we often double up for Hong Kong. Yeah. Happens quite a lot. Thank you to BAFTA and to Cineworld for having us. And a massive thank you, Pete, and congratulations. I absolutely loved it.
Oh, no, I'm glad you
really enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for having me.